Hello, my name is Daniel Margolis from Weill, Cornell Medical College, and it's my privilege to speak to you today on imaging for male infertility and impotence as part of the American Rankin Ray Society Men's Health Awareness Month this November 2020. I should mention I have a couple disclosures. I've been a consultant for Blue Earth Diagnostics, and Cornell is the recipient of a research agreement with Siemens Health and Ears. The overview of this presentation is that it will consist of three components. The first is the use of ultrasound to evaluate male infertility. The second portion will be the use of MRI, also in the evaluation of male factor infertility. And finally, I'll discuss some techniques for the evaluation of erectile dysfunction. Male factor infertility affects up to half of infertile couples, and erectile dysfunction will affect up to 30 million American men at some point in their lifetimes. Both of these issues are multifactorial, and the etiologies vary by age. As you can see from the pie chart on the right side of this image, the vast majority of male factor infertility is testicular in nature, with the second largest portion being considered idiopathic, where no cause is identified. Transport issues, or those issues that deal with the seminal vesicles, the vas deferens, and ejaculatory ducts, are a small proportion. And hypogonadism or hormonal effects are another small proportion. Now I'd like to address the use of ultrasound in the evaluation of male factor infertility. Most factors that relate to male factor infertility are not imaged. The main utility of imaging, primarily ultrasound, is to evaluate testis volume, but also to rule out the presence of a mass or scar that may impact transport. There is also potential use of imaging for endocrine evaluation, specifically the adrenal glands and the pituitary. The prostate, seminal vesicles, and vasodifferentia are the last portions to be evaluated if all other possibilities have been exhausted. And here we see a diagram from Abbott et al. In AJR of August 1991. That illustrates the components of transport and how they may be affected. Testicular ultrasound is the mainstay for the use of ultrasound in evaluation of male factor infertility. One would only consider obstructive azoospermia if all of the following are normal: testicular volumes, which should be between about 10 and 20 milliliters in adults, the paratesticular veins, specifically one wants to rule out the presence of a varicocele, which may impact male fertility. One will also evaluate the vasodifferentia in terms of any palpable abnormalities. This is usually done by the referring endocrine or fertility specialist. And finally, laboratory analyses of serum testosterone, follicle stimulating hormone, and luteinizing hormone are evaluated last. Endorectal ultrasound uses a technique similar to that used for transrectal ultrasound-guided biopsy of the prostate as part of cancer workup. However, the focus in infertility is quite different. The main structures we need to evaluate are the vasa deferentia, seminal vesicles, ejaculatory ducts, and urethra, or the components of transport. Standardized measurements are generally sufficient to evaluate these structures, and CineClips may augment challenging cases. In terms of the utility of endorectal ultrasound, the goal is to identify whether there may be an obstructing lesion. This may only be inferred by the presence of seminal vesicle dilation, vas deferens dilation, or the presence of hemorrhage or calcification. But the obstructing lesion may also be readily evident, as I will show you with an example. Here we see some common static images that are used in the endorectal ultrasonographic evaluation of the prostate and the adjoining organs. We can see the AP, sagittal, and transverse measurements on the left side of the image. I would also point out that on the sagittal image, you can see the urinary bladder as an anechoic structure with the bladder outlet entering the prostate immediately opposite the presence of the ultrasound probe. And similarly, on the transverse image below it, we see a hypochoic area at the top part of the image or the anterior part of the prostate, which represents the bladder outlet and the proximal prostatic urethra. The other images show the measurements of the seminal vesicles and the vas deferens. The seminal vesicles will normally measure up to 2.5 by 1.5 centimeters and the vas deferens 4 millimeters or less. We also want to evaluate the ejaculatory duct. These are generally quite subtle and are best evaluated by an oblique sagittal acquisition following the seminal vesicles towards the location of the veromontanum. The veromontanum being the mid portion of the prostatic urethra, where the ejaculatory ducts enter. And finally, we also want to evaluate the distal urethra. You can see on the bottom right image, anteriorly, there is an anechoic structure, but this is well below the urinary bladder and is, of course, the pubic symphysis. We can also see the lower portion of the prostate and the urethra coursing towards the right side of the image, where it becomes the membranous urethra. This image can be very difficult to acquire because of the steep angle necessary and can be very uncomfortable for the patient. We usually leave it as one of the last images to acquire because very often the patient will defer any further imaging. Here we see in a CineClip a oblique transverse and longitudinal or sagittal image of the seminal vesicles, in this case on the left aspect of the prostate. And we see that rather than a normal vesicle structure, as we saw in the previous images, that this is a thick-walled cyst. And in fact, on the sagittal CineClip, we see that this echogenic thick wall extends along the course of the ejaculatory duct. There are other bright reflectors in the prostate, which likely reflect inspissated material. Here we see a transverse CineClip from the level of the seminal vesicles through the prostate. And we can see at the base of the prostate, there is a Müllerian duct remnant cyst. The static image at the bottom right shows us measuring the cyst immediately below the dilated seminal vesicle. And the static image at the top right shows the distended vas deferens, which we can also see in the transverse cineclip. So this Müllerian duct remnant cyst has resulted in obstruction to the point where the seminal vesicles have transformed into cystic sacs. And also we see dilation of the vas deferens as they would join with the seminal vesicles to form the ejaculatory ducts. The reason we describe this as a Müllerian duct remnant cyst rather than a utricular cyst is, of course, because it arises well above the veromontanum. The utricle cyst will arise from the veromontanum and it will extend superiorly, but it should extend to the level of the midportion of the prostate. A cyst which forms wholly at the base of the prostate is therefore more likely a Müllerian duct remnant cyst. And here we see an example of a calculus. The transverse cine image shows a echogenic structure with a hypocoic rim in the right seminal vesicles. And we see this in sagittal and transverse orientation on the static images on the right. This does not itself constitute an obstructive lesion being so peripheral. However, it may infer the presence of an obstruction, which is resulting in inspissated secretions, although the remainder of the seminal vesicles appears relatively normal. And this brings us to considering the use of MRI for the evaluation of male infertility. MRI to evaluate the seminal vesicles and for benign prostatic disease can be used to characterize abnormalities of the seminal vesicles similar to the way we would with ultrasound, as well as abnormalities in the prostate. It's very sensitive to hemorrhage with the T1 shortening. It may be less sensitive to calculi, and it depends largely on the way that the calculi are formed in terms of how shortened the T1 may be. The T1 may be shortened to the point where it's very bright, but can actually shorten so much that it results in a signal void, which may limit the ability to detect it. We can also evaluate seminal vesicle morphology, and I'll show you an example of that. The technique that we use is very similar to that used for the detection of cancer, with the potential addition of a 3D T2-weighted image for the improved through-plane resolution. The main reason that we use the same technique is simplicity. The diffusion images are primarily only useful for the evaluation of inflammatory conditions such as abscess. And the dynamic contrast images also are useful for inflammatory conditions, but it's simplest to have one composite protocol. And we can see from this citation in the right side of the image, the first use of MRI to evaluate male infertility was published in 1986 by Hedvig Gritzak, the chair of radiology at Memorial Sloan Kettering, and the urologist Dale McClure. We can see seminal vesicles very nicely with both T2 and T1 weighted imaging. You can see that the seminal vesicles on the transverse and coronal T2-weighted image here look fairly normal. On the T1-weighted images, though, we see that there is marked T1 shortening. and on the axial image through the mid portion of the prostate, just above the veromontanum. We can see that this T1 shortening, identifying hemorrhage, extends along the ejaculatory ducts. This will be an example of the use of MRI to evaluate structural abnormalities in the seminal vesicles. So here on these coronal images, we see complete absence of the left seminal vesicles. And while the seminal vesicles are identified on the right, when evaluating both the sagittal reformat and the axial source 3D images, we can see that these are not truly vesicles, but effectively a complex cyst. And this lack of normal vesicle structure precludes the normal excretion of seminal vesicle fluid. And this brings us to the use of imaging for the evaluation of erectile dysfunction. Erectile dysfunction can affect all age groups. Approximately half of all cases are vasogenic. And this is also true across all age groups. But there are a number of additional factors, such as neurologic and drug-induced. Obviously, this can also impact fertility. The first technique generally utilized, other than to evaluate for nocturnal tumescence, is whether or not the patients respond adequately to phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitors, such as Viagra. If there is an adequate response, it is likely not a vasogenic cause. Ultrasound, MRI, and CT all have value to evaluate the various potential causes of male impotence. They can also be used for related abnormalities such as Peyronie disease, but obviously are useful for the evaluation of vascular abnormalities and injury, and potentially for neurological evaluation, such as sacral plexus imaging. The order and the modality choice are determined clinically based on the level of suspicion for the various potential etiologies. This is an example of Peyronie disease. We see both an ultrasound and a CT image, and we see that there is plaque along tunica albuginea. In this case, it also involves the septum between the corpora cavernosa and spongiosum. The fibrous plaque can be calcified, or rather it can be fibrous or calcified. Generally, ultrasound is the test of choice because it is equally effective in identifying both fibrous and calcified plaque, whereas CT is primarily only useful for calcified plaque. One should also consider that these patients may progress to the point where they need a penile prosthesis, and understanding the imaging and especially the safety of penile prostheses can be important in this cohort. The use of imaging for vasogenic ED usually begins with ultrasound. It's important to manually trace the penile vessels, and the primary use of ultrasound is the use of Doppler for the evaluation of hemodynamics. Cavernosography and angiography were previously mainstays of the evaluation in male impotence. However, MRA now allows for time-resolved imaging and may replace these techniques. And as we see in the CINE image, you can see an early blush along the right aspect with early venous drainage bilaterally. And so as we consider the use of imaging, let's first start with ultrasound. There is a very nice review article in AJR 2020 from Varela et al. That describes the use of spectral duplex Doppler ultrasound. It describes imaging both in the tumescent and detumescent state. However, the evaluation is primarily based on those measurements taken during tumescence. And this generally requires intracavernosal injection of tumescent agents, such as PDE inhibitors and papaverin. One evaluates both the peak systolic velocity and end diastolic velocity, as well as the resistive index of the penile arteries. And the various components, peak systolic velocity, end diastolic velocity, and resistive index, help distinguish between the potential causes of vasogenic erectile dysfunction, specifically whether it is more likely arterial inflow or venous outflow that is abnormal. You can see that the peak systolic velocity is primarily useful for the evaluation of arterial inflow abnormalities, and the end diastolic velocity and resistive index are primarily useful for the evaluation of a venous outflow abnormality. This is an example of the use of ultrasound before and after treatment. So the practitioner was able to identify the abnormal course of a vessel, which fed into an arteriovenous malformation. And we can see that after successful ligation, that there's absent spectral Doppler flow. Most importantly, though, the patient was able to return to normal function. When evaluating time-resolved MRA, the time-resolved aspect is crucial. It allows us to evaluate the pelvic arteries, the early enhancement of penile arteries, and especially detection of blush or focal abnormal enhancement, and early venous drainage. One normally only expects to see venous drainage after a couple minutes, and the presence of early venous drainage can help identify an abnormal outflow problem. On the images we see here, at the penoscrotal junction on the right, on the middle image where we begin to see the penile arteries, there are focal abnormal areas of enhancement. And on the slightly delayed image, we see multiple areas of early venous drainage. It's important that the technologists are able to recognize that the patient is adequately tumescent. Again, we require pharmacologic tumescence to maintain the status throughout the evaluation. We would commonly work closely with our urologists who would inject the patient. Again, this is an intracavernosal injection. And then we would time this such that the patient was on the table with the phased array coils in place within half an hour of the injection. The imaging itself takes about 15 minutes. There's approximately 5-minute time resolved component, including the setup and the wash in and wash out phases, with about 3 minutes of imaging during the time resolved component, as well as anatomic imaging. The T2-aided imaging can generally be acquired after the time resolved injection. Here are some representative images that illustrate the important vascular anatomy we consider in the evaluation of arterial inflow. So as we see, the normal course is common iliac to internal pudendal to the common penile artery. And this leads into the dorsal artery, We also need to consider that there are cavernosal arteries. These are two coronal images showing the cavernosal arteries in the more anterior aspect, as well as at the penoscrotal junction, where we see them in cross-section along with the dorsal arteries. We can also generate oblique coronal projections. In general, the standard time-resolved coronal MIP is adequate to evaluate for the presence of early venous drainage and the anatomy. The sagittal time-resolved MIP may help characterize the anterior-posterior location of an abnormality. Generally, though, we look at the source images from the first image where we begin to see the penile arteries enhancing, and then approximately every 2 to 5 seconds afterwards to evaluate the presence of abnormal venous leakage, if suggested on the MIP. Here you see a comparison between a vascular abnormality initially identified and suggested based on ultrasound, but you can see that there is effectively a blush as well as an early enhancing dorsal artery that leads to this vascular malformation at the glands. We can also generate a volume reconstruction. This is generally not particularly helpful for diagnosis, which is based primarily on the time-resolved MIP and the source images, but can be exquisitely helpful to the surgeon for the resolution of surface anatomy in order to plan management. The take-home points I would like to reinforce in terms of imaging male factor infertility and impotence is that the imaging of male factor infertility may include the testes, the seminal vesicles, and the vasodeferentia. Ultrasound remains the test of choice, primarily to evaluate the testes. Ultrasound or potentially MRI can be used to evaluate transport, specifically the seminal vesicles. Magnetic resonance angiography can be a valuable adjunct to spectral duplex Doppler ultrasound for the evaluation of erectile dysfunction. But both MRA and ultrasound rely on adequate tumescence, and MRA relies on time-resolved technique. I'd like to acknowledge the kind invitation of Nicholas Gieda and the American Rankin Ray Society to present this discussion of male factor infertility and evaluation of erectile dysfunction. I'd like to also thank my chair for supporting the development of these techniques at my institution, the urologist with whom I've worked very closely to apply these techniques to our patients, my colleagues in radiology, my former fellow Alexandra Rudenko and my current colleague Chris Song, who published an excellent discussion of the utility of dynamic MRA in the evaluation of male erectile dysfunction this year in abdominal radiology. I'd also like to thank our other referrers and our patients, and especially, and certainly not least of all, my technologists for their expediency considering the time-crucial nature of this evaluation. Thank you very much for your attention.